Amen. Good morning. Let's stand together and sing, I heard an old, old story, Victory in Jesus. I heard an old, old story, how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood.
Of the Lord. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We're asking God to do something great, special for us today. Father, we love you. Accept our praise and our worship and our thanksgiving because we ask it in Jesus' name. All of God's people said amen. You may be seated. Come on, choir.
Worried in my soul where this old world may go or what I see on the news today. And I'm not weeping with regret. I have chosen not to fret about this ever-changing world and its ways. For I put my attention on that heavenly intervention that brought me out of darkness to the light. It's not mind over matter. More than worthless chatter, it's all about the blood of Jesus Christ.
I still have a Bible, a guide to survival that brought me to this place. I still believe in Christians, old-time convictions are the answer for this modern day.
Oh,
moving across the nations and proving that He is still the same today. And there's not a different approach. It remains as He wrote, and He can't be explained away. They may say our conviction, this old time religion, must all be rearranged. Oh, but I've been on my knees to God, reassured me that some things never, never change.
And I still have a Bible, a guide to the Bible that brought me to this place. I still believe the Christians, old time convictions are the answer to this modern day. Old saints are still praying, sinners still restrained, are receiving God's saving grace. Yes, the old rugged cross still saving the lost. Thank God, some things never change. Yes, the old rugged cross still saving the lost. Saving the lost. Thank God, some things never change. I still have a Bible, a guide to survival that brought me to this place. I still believe the Christians, old time convictions are the answer for this modern day. Old saints are still praying, and sinners who restrain are receiving God's saving grace. Yes, the old rugged cross is saving the lost. Thank God, some things never change. Yes, the old rugged cross.
Let's stand together, shake hands, fellowship a little bit. Welcome one another to the house of the Lord. You may be seated. We want to do something this morning, being the 4th of July weekend. And let's do a patriotic number, Brother Jerry. Let's do My Country, Tis of Thee. And while we're singing that first verse, if you've ever or have served in our armed services or been in civil service or something like that, where you've served others for our country, your city, our county, I want to recognize everybody today. I thank the Lord for our freedom. I thank God for our freedom. And since we're on the internet live for the world to hear, thank God for the freedom of the unborn. Amen. Right. You bunch of jaybirds out there that call abortion human rights, you're a barbaric. And to claim to be a Christian and a preacher, you need a double dose to something called old-time religion. This message has been brought to you by the Harvest Baptist Tabernacle in Jonesboro, Georgia, and I, Joe Arthur, approve this message. Amen. Praise God. I do. Now, back to my nicer side. Glad you're here today. Thank you for coming. About like a fellow handed me a tract one time, had the name of their church. It said, such and such Baptist church, devil chasing, sin killing. They had like 15 things they were against, and the bottom it said, we love you. But anyway, we're glad you're here. And let's do My Country, Tis of Thee, Brother Jerry. And I want all of our military civil servants, past, present, come on down in the front. My country
of the sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims tried, from every mountainside, let freedom
be. We're going to sing the last verse again in just a moment. All right, now let's see if we got any Coast Guard here. Wesley, Coast Guard. There we go. I want you to, yes, sir. And how many Navy boys we got? Navy boys we got. All right. And Army, come on, Shirley, Army. I'll tell you. And then, and what's that other one? It's Air Force. All right, here we go now. Then there's one more. All right, you Marines, check in on me over there now. All right. And any other man that's married, you take orders too. Can I say amen right there? Let's give them all a hand. Thank you so very much. God bless you. Let's sing that last verse as they go back.
Father God, to thee, Father of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's golden light. Hallelujah, I might break God, our King.
Let's give a hand for America and our freedoms and our heritage and our forefathers. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Our ushers are coming now to receive our morning tithe and offering. I appreciate everyone who faithfully supports the church, either by bringing it or mailing it or giving online. And we appreciate that so very much. The sun never sets on our ministry. And we have mission projects all over the world right now. And we're trying to reach our city as well. I think, Joseph, we should be up to about 600 pretty close doors so far, over. And our goal is 5,000 for this summer. And what a shame it would be to send millions of dollars to foreign countries and let our own county go to hell. So we're going to reach our county and our city and the world with the power of the gospel. And I appreciate the faith for giving of God's people. And for our offertory today, we got a bunch of bell ringers. This is going to be good. And I love to hear them do this on Easter, patriotic days and all. And these ladies up here are not taking my picture. They've got a kid up here somewhere, and that's good. And I think that's wonderful. And what Brother Tom is doing, he's teaching these kids how to read music because he knows that's his future choir back there. And that's why we try to teach your children the Bible. That's our church in the future. Amen. And so there's a reason behind all of this. We praise the Lord for that. Continue to pray for the camp meeting. We had three good nights, and we're looking forward to starting again tomorrow at 5 o'clock through Friday night. I understand the weather may get a little hot, but just pray for us. God will meet the need, and we'll have a wonderful, wonderful time. Our Father, I pray that you'll take the offering today, use it for thy glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. that's great. Wonderful. Praise the goodness of the Lord. God is so good. We're going to do one more Patriot song. We're glad to have Brother Mike Holcomb with us today. And Mike is no stranger to our place. In fact, he's an honorary member. He just don't know it. But we love him and Miss Boo and his family. He's going to preach for us in just a moment. But I want them to do Statue of Liberty. Now, you don't want to miss the service tonight. We're going to have just a big time of singing and preaching. We're going to have fun tonight. I'm having fun right now. I have fun when I go to church. I'm glad I'm not so religious I can enjoy myself. But anyway, you don't want to miss it tonight. We'll have a wonderful time. But I want to do this before Brother Mike comes and brings the message. I'm glad I have a Statue of Liberty as an American. But I'm glad I got a Statue of Liberty, an old rugged cross for my salvation. And they may take our liberties here in America. We have politicians that want to take our liberties here in America. But my spiritual liberty can never be taken away. Because Jesus said, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And if the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. Praise the Lord. Come on, Brother Mike, get ready. And I thank the Lord for the tree.
For it was there that my soul
honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I thank God for America. I thank God for our freedom. I thank God for our nation. But I want to tell you something. We'd be in a real mess if it hadn't been for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We'd all be lost and in our sin, dying without Christ, spending a Christless eternity in hell. And I want to make sure this world knows I love my Lord and I love my Savior. He's my best friend. He's my rock. He's my advocate. He's my representative. He's my daysman. He's my great high priest. He's my Lord, Savior. He's my shepherd, my good shepherd, my great shepherd, my chief shepherd. He's King of kings and Lord of lords. And amen. The rose of Sharon, the lily of the valley, the bright morning star, the rock of ages, my refuge, my fortress, mighty God, Prince of Peace, everlasting Father, Savior, Jesus is his name. And he is worthy of all of our praise. And right before the preacher, I want him to come and make sure we let this world know we're glad we're Americans, but most of all, we're glad we believe Jesus. And they ended the book of the Revelation with praise the Lamb. And I want us to praise the Lamb for sinners slain. He is worthy of our praise. If you hadn't had a shouting spell this morning, you're behind on your praise. Give him glory. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Hallelujah.
When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I obeyed the Spirit's wooing when he said, "Wilt thou be clean?" But then God's fire upon the altar of my heart was set aflame. I shall never cease to pray. Glory to him.
glory, all ye people. For his blood can wash away each stain. Oh, glory, glory to his name.
That was worth 2 extra minutes. I love Brother Mike Holcomb. When I was a little old boy, I used to go hear him sing. And that ain't no lie, but he was a little old boy too. Well, he ain't never been a little old boy, but I love this dear man of God, and you pray for him. Let's give a big tabernacle welcome to our friend, Mike Holcomb. Bless you, buddy. Turn it up, son.
Well, I think I distorted call recess and shout a while. Thank God for the blood of Jesus that washed my sins away. Good to be back at Tabernacle. Always good to be here. Appreciate all of you, and thank God for your pastor and his family and the church family. I'm thankful for the fact that, if we are honorary members, I'm sorry we haven't paid tithe. But I'm thankful to be here and praise the Lord. I want to give you just few simple thoughts this morning. Trust the Lord will bless. 1 Peter chapter number 1, begin there. 1 Peter chapter number 1, verse 3. Dr. Lee Robertson said there's nothing better than hear people turning the pages of God's Word. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse number 3, the Bible said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again." Anybody been born again? Yeah, that's what he's talking about. The being born again unto a lively hope. I'm glad my hope's not dead. I'm not hoping in Atlanta, and I'm not hoping in Washington, I'm not hoping in Raleigh. I'm not hoping even in you. I'm hoping in a living Savior today. The one who died, and yet he told John, said, "Write it down. I once was dead, but now I'm alive forevermore." A lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. What for? To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept, hallelujah, by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. I want to call your attention just for a few moments to a thought that the Lord crossed my mind with the other day, and I trust that it'll make sense to you. It did to me then. I hope it does today. Real, true freedom. Real, true freedom. Father, I ask you now to bless your word. May it touch our hearts and lives. May somebody today be drawn to Jesus to find that real, true freedom in Christ. God, I beg you to touch hearts and lives for your glory. I'm unworthy as I can be, and I feel totally unprepared for the day. But I praise the Lord, I serve a God that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that I could ever ask or think. I ask you now to touch hearts and lives. May Jesus be magnified. May Christ be exalted. May he be lifted up in such a way as he would draw men unto himself. We'll thank you for what you accomplish in Christ's name. Amen and amen. In the book of Romans, chapter number 8, verse 19, the Bible said, "For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God." We have a glorious liberty as the children of God. We've come here today that we might praise Him, honor Him, worship Him, and have the liberty to gather together in such a way as to magnify His name. We thank God for America. We thank God for our freedoms. We thank God for all that has been done that we might have this privilege. But the best privilege of all is that to be gathered together in one mind and one accord in one place, that we might honor, magnify, and glorify the name that is above every other name, the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. And by the way, this is good here. This is wonderful here. And it's been a good and glorious life that God's given us to live here. But thank God there is one coming that's even better than what we have now. We have been given the liberty into the glory of the children of God. There's coming a far greater freedom than we can even imagine. Lord willing, tomorrow, the 4th of July, our Independence Day here in this country, a day that we who really love the U.S. of A. cherish. It's a day we come together to celebrate our liberation from England. The day America declared its independence and became a nation separate and independent of all other governments. But we as Christians have a better Independence Day. That's the day we got saved. That's the day we got born again. That's the day we got washed in the blood of the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. That's the day we became a new creature in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's the day we were given a brand new destination to spend eternity in a place far better than we can even dream of, tagged for glory. As Brother Mays Jackson used to say, made us heaven bound with a hammer down. Oh, what a glorious liberty we, the children of God, have. That we not only have the privilege to be in the house of God to praise Him and honor Him today, but we got a far better expectation of where we're going and how we're going to get there. By the goodness of God, by the grace of God, by the mercies of God, whosoever will can enjoy in that liberty. Now, freedom means many things to many people. We can view freedom politically as having the opportunity to vote particular ideas, particular people, particular parties, which seemingly best represent our views. I can't find one that really does. Hello? And there are a lot of things that... Well, the freedom of speech is very important to many of us who feel that we have liberty to voice our personal opinion or give our personal perspective. If you've ever been married, you've got in on that too. Others understand freedom in a financial context where they seek to free themselves from debt and are never able to. It is interesting to me that many freedoms being sought after today are seen as being ends in themselves, as a final goal that is to be attained. It's as though that some folks think that once a individual particular freedom is achieved, that all their problems are going to be solved. Why? Why would they think this way? Because there will be a little bit, some freedom. But freedom from what? Freedom to do what? Freedom to be what? So what does real, true freedom look like? Does it look like a voter's ballot? Or does it look like someone walking out of prison? Is it seen in being able to buy anything that we want, or the fact that we really don't owe anybody for anything? It's critical to define what we mean by freedom so that we may know what we're looking for and what we're hoping to attain. Now, there are a few obstacles to our freedom. We all know what many of them are. But the number one obstacle to freedom is the bondage of the unsaved. Just as this USA was in bondage under the rule of the King of England until the Revolutionary War, so is the lost person under the bondage to Satan and the forces of evil. Sin and the devil rule the lives of those who are unsaved through deception. I'm afraid there's a whole lot of folks in this world today that want to celebrate freedom in America, but they have no idea that the bondage that they're under. The devil is the master at deception. We know him to be the father of lies. He makes the unsaved to think evil is good and that good is evil. Can anybody recognize the fact that that's where we are in America today? Our society today, the unsaved especially, the far left, thinks that good is evil and evil is good. That tradition is old fogey, old fashioned, and should be done away with, and that the new, the modern, the anything goes crowd be in charge. Amen. There is a cry going out around the world today for freedom. Some of it is for good, but some of it is not for good, because the devil wants the supremacy in the lives of the masses of the people. He makes folks to believe that it's good for them to get whatever they want. He makes people to believe that it's good for them to do whatever they want. He makes people to understand that they can be whatever they want. Amen. From the time they're little bitty ones now, they ask them whether or not they want to be boys or they want to be girls. And they have the opportunity at 4 and 5 years old to decide that for themselves. That's a freedom. And it's wrong. And it's not good. And some of the best freedom that you can ever enjoy as an individual is not good. With no reprimand or no penalty. The theology of the day is, let me do as I please, let me do what I want, let me be whatever I want to be, and don't say anything about it. Bring no condemnation, bring no reprimand, and don't cause me any problem with it. Amen. But the Bible, the inerrant, infallible, inexhaustible, impeccable Word of God, does not treat freedom in such a manner. To be really free, to be truly free, means that you understand and comprehend what God's instruction book has to say, and you follow it to find exactly where and what God wants you to be. Politically, economically, morally, socially, this world is crying out for freedom. But the majority do not know what real, true freedom is. In Psalm chapter 33, verse 10, the Bible said, "The Lord maketh the counsel of the heathen to naught. He maketh the devices of the people of none effect. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever, the thoughts of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his own inheritance." There is an overwhelming abundance of ignorance today of the mercy, the grace, and the love of the Lord Jesus in the hearts and lives of people all over this world. Never before in the history of mankind has there been more absence of the knowledge of the one true and living God than there is today. Amen. We think we're smarter, we think we're better, we think we're far excelling above every other society that has ever been, and yet there is less knowledge of the truth and less knowledge of reality and less knowledge of the real in our lives than there ever has been before. This flesh we live in is weak. We know it's temporary, and we know it's only superficial. The Bible tells us that even our heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I'm glad right behind it comes quickly the answer. I, the Lord, search the heart and try the reins and even give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. If Jesus is not ruling and reigning in the heart, ruling in love and in mercy in your soul, then lives are spent in reckless abandonment and folks live in ruin. Why is that, preacher? Because no one can free themselves from our depraved nature on our own. We cannot free ourselves because we are under bondage to our sin. Because we're too selfish, because we're too self-seeking. The sinful, wicked desires of flesh and to do whatever we want drives us to guilt and to doing many things against God and against our fellow man. Why are people doing the crazy, ungodly, wicked things that they're doing? Because they know not God. Because they have not been set free. Because they're still chained down to their sin, chained to themselves, chained to their own flesh, chained to their own mind, chained to the way that the devil would have them to live, and they don't even realize it. Real, true freedom is to be set free from sin and from self. Freedom of the mind, freedom of the will, freedom of the soul. But it is attainable. Hallelujah needs to go right in there. It is attainable. Not by ways that we have known. Not by our own understanding. Not by our own means. Not by our own education. But by the grace of God. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 13. And I promise I'm almost done. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme or under governors, as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free, and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Can I go on record to tell you today, my king is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. To honor him, I honor Jesus. To honor him, I praise the name of the Lord. To honor him, I try to live according to the dictates of the Word of God that brings me into liberty beyond anything that I've ever enjoyed any other way. I'm glad I can pull over to the side of the road and have myself a shouting spell and it don't bother anybody in the car. Because when God's in the car and he takes over and I begin to praise him and worship him and glorify him, it doesn't matter what anybody else has to say. I love him. Why? Because he first loved me and he gave himself for me. So what is real, true freedom? Who is really, truly free? Who deserves to be free? No one is really, truly free until they're free from their sin and free from their self. John 8:34, Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth ever. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed." The only person really and the only truly free has been set free by Jesus. Amen. The only person who is really free, the only person who is truly free has been set free by Jesus Christ himself. The only person who deserves to be free is the one who is saved born again, washed in the blood, made a new creature in Christ Jesus, who is living his life controlled by the Holy Spirit of God, and uses that freedom for God's glory. For God's glory, not for ourselves, not to pat us on the back, not to make us look bigger or better than somebody else, but to make those to know that we know him. That we know him because he first knew us. Galatians chapter 1 verse 5. The Bible says, "Stand fast therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage." This Bible has several do's and it has several don'ts that are recorded within its pages. They are to set us free. They are giving to us as instruments that our lives might be governed by the word and the will of God. That we could go by this and bring honor and glory to him. It's never been about you. It's always been about him. All things were made by him and for him. When we're saved by the grace of God, we don't belong to us anymore. We've been given the liberty to live for Jesus. Some folks think that they're been saved by the grace of God so they can live like they want to. No, you're saved by the grace of God so you can live like you ought to. Whoa, the blessedness of our liberty in God. I thank God for the privilege to be a citizen of the U.S. of A. I thank God for this country and the liberties, many of them that we still enjoy as free Americans. But those of us who are saved enjoy an even greater freedom, that the soul of liberty given to us by the new birth in Jesus brought us into the family of God. That new birth has given us freedom from our sin, freedom from ourselves, and freedom from Satan. The lost, the unsaved, are living every moment under the condemnation of their sin, which is eventually hell for all eternity. Oh my. Some folks, Brother Joe, I appreciate this atmosphere, and I appreciate the freedom to preach what the Word of God has to say. A lot of folks today don't want you to mention hell in their church or in their context around them. They don't want their children scared of a place called hell. If that would get your child saved, I'd jump up and down and holler hell in their ear, because there is a real, literal, burning hell. And all those who are unsaved when Jesus comes are going there. They're going to wind up there for all eternity. Years ago, I was about 15 years old when I first started singing in a gospel quartet. And the fellow that was singing lead was, he was an x-ray technician at the hospital. And we would come together to practice usually on Friday night to practice, and we wouldn't hardly get started until the phone would ring and he'd have to go off to the hospital. Somebody'd had a wreck, something had happened, and he'd have to go make x-rays. And a lot of times we would go with him. And I got to the hospital one day and I was green as grass and didn't know nothing. I was just absolutely unbelievable dumb. And the doctor came in. We were making x-rays, and all I was doing was just helping to change this or that or the other to do what I was told. Hello? It's amazing. If we'll just do what we're told. Some of you didn't get it yet. If we just do what we're told. I was doing what I was told when the doctor came in, and he started talking about a party he was going to. And he said, "I actually want to go to hell where all the parties are." Being as uneducated and as dumb as I was, I really didn't know what to tell him. And so the word of God popped up in my mouth and it said, "There ain't going to be no parties in hell." He said, what do you mean? I said, according to the word of God, there's nothing there but weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. It's a place of torment. It's a place where there's never a song sung. It's a place where nobody ever wants to be. Nobody wants to hear your voice. Nobody wants to talk to you. Nobody wants to fellowship with you. Nobody wants to have anything. They don't want anybody there because they're there. Amen. I said, there's not going to be any parties in hell. The doctor turned his head and he walked away, feeling like he was superior to me, feeling like he was superior to my theology, but he wasn't superior to the Word of God. We have been delivered as children of God. We have been delivered from that awful place called hell. We not only don't have to go, we're not going. Amen. I love that song. I'm not going to hell. I don't have to even get close to the place. I'm free. I'm set free because of and by the Lord Jesus Christ. Been given eternal life, been given eternal love, been given eternal liberty. Even the grave can't keep us back. The trumpet's going to sound, the voice is going to ring out with a shout. The dead in Christ are going to rise first. You know, ever since I was a little fellow, I thought that was the Baptist. The dead in Christ are going to rise first. I've always believed that to be Baptist. We're going to rise first, and then those which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And we're going to rise up to be caught away to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. I guess I've been, well, I know I have, been to more funerals this year in particular than I have in 20. Friends and families. About a month ago, my last remaining uncle passed away. He was my mother's brother. He died on Monday. His wife passed away on Wednesday. And we had a double funeral on Saturday. And when we laid them in the ground, all I could think of is, it ain't going to hold them. It ain't going to hold them. I know that's not good English, but it's real good preaching. It ain't going to hold them, because one day they'll hear that trumpet sound and that voice ring out with a shout, and the cemetery is going to unload all of those that are born again. Rise up to meet him in the air, because the creature itself shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. We're going to get a new body. I'm a needing one. They're having to put in spare parts for me every now and then. Just a couple of weeks ago, they took cataracts out of my eyes and they put a glass lens in both eyes. Now, I can see you okay. You're not real clear at the moment, but I can see you okay. It's amazing how bright things got when that took place. Amen. I had to preach at Taylorsville camp meeting a couple of weeks ago, and I had to preach in sunglasses because it was so bright. And there were several of the preachers there, and I'll not mention any names, but they called me Hollywood while I was there wearing sunglasses. I'm getting new parts along the journey. Several years ago, Dr. Ralph Sexton Sr.'s wife Jackie was in the hospital. She'd had her ankle replaced, she'd had her knee replaced, she'd had her elbow replaced, she'd had some joints put in. She told him, she said, you know what, when Jesus comes, you can recycle me. But I'm going to get better than recycled. I'm going to be renewed. Why? Because of the freedom that we're going to have that day in Jesus. Get a new body, likened unto his glorified body, free from every imperfection. I wonder today, have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Songwriter put it this way: I'm free from the load I once carried, from the dull, empty life I'm set free. For when I met Jesus, he made me complete. He forgot the foolish child I used to be. I'm free from the fear of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last. Are you really, truly free? Pastor's coming. Brother Tom's coming. Are you really, truly free? There is absolutely nothing at all more important than knowing that you know, that you know, that you know you're free. Stand to your feet, please.
I'm going to get Brother Tom to sing that. Aren't you thankful today for your freedom?
So long.
What about your lost loved ones?
I had searched for life's meaning.
What about your lost friends?
Greetings, everyone. This is Pastor Joe Arthur from right here at the Harvest Baptist Tabernacle in Jonesboro, Georgia. And I want to personally thank you for joining us today for our online service. I trust the singing, the preaching, the service was a blessing to your life. I trust that it birthed faith and hope and victory in your heart. And if you've tuned in today and you have any questions about your relationship with Jesus Christ, feel free to get in touch with us. We would love to help you come to know Christ and grow in the grace of God. If you're ever in the Atlanta area, I want to extend a personal invitation for you to come and join us. We're right off of Interstate 75 south of the city of Atlanta and the beautiful Lake Spivey community. And we would love to have you come and be with us on Sunday and enjoy the service. I would love an opportunity to meet you and your family. I trust you will pray for us here at Harvest. We have a very large mission program. We're involved in a lot of different mission projects. The Lord has been so gracious in opening so many doors, and we need your prayers for wisdom that God will help us follow the path that he has laid before us. If I'm ever preaching in your area, I'd love for you to come, and I'd love to greet you and let us know that you're watching our program. Again, thanks for coming by. And join us again for our next scheduled program, and we'll see what God will do in our lives.